Welcome to Starfleet Boy, where we have a casual and informal discussion about our beloved series, Star Trek. Back on another exciting episode of Starfleet Boy, where we have a casual and informal conversation about Star Trek. Today we're focused on Star Trek The Next Generation's rightful heir. Oh, that's so good for the ASMR audience.
It's my notes.
These, my dear friends, are my notes.
Wow, we should do the whole episode in soft, calm voices close to the mic.
Except for Picard.
Sean, what I learned from this episode is that Star Trek Discovery has divided the Star Trek Empire, and already there are people who are following Star Trek Discovery blindly. Star Trek's return could not have been the same as the legend had foreseen, but it's still a return nonetheless. I think this episode is a mini-cosm for the entire hubbub over Star Trek Discovery. I was, like, feeling it.
Is it really?
Yes. The lesson. The lesson is the same. Kalis returned. He thought he was himself. He found out he was a fucking clone.
Oh, my goodness. So you're saying that Discovery is not real Trek?
No, I'm saying it is real Trek, but it's not the same. It's like Kalis coming back in this episode.
I see what you mean. It's like, been infused, you know, with a few of the memories of Star Trek.
Right.
That's what. But then you see
not
that.
Even a few, lots of memories, because this ties in a huge thing. Like in TOS, you have that episode with the Rock people, and we get Kalis and Sirak and Abraham Lincoln. Did you ever see that one?
That's weird. I remember that.
Then you have this episode, and then Discovery has Point of Light, which Worf directly says the little prophecy. He's like, there on that point of light, you will find me. You will discover the truth about Kalis. Star Trek is the same. So that's all I have to say about that whole thing. And that was my episode summary as well. Did you like it?
No.
Allowed you to eat. No, you didn't like the summary at all.
How was that the summary?
That was a good summary.
I don't feel summoned.
Do you want me to give? Do you want to give a better summary, or do you want to give it?
I think I can give a better one. You think I can give? I can give a better one than that.
Well, you can give a more factual and precise one that stays on the episode and doesn't go into a whole rant about Star Trek Discovery.
All right, let's do a different rant. A few episodes ago. Worf tried to impose his view of what a Klingon is onto a bunch of young people living with a bunch of young Klingons living with a bunch of Romulans, and that didn't go well. And so now he's depressed. This episode picks up. Oh, look at that! That's amazing. I want one of those. Send it my way. You're doing this to interrupt my summary.
Do you see what it says?
Picard family.
Could you tell the audio audience at home what you're looking at? What you're looking at? Well, it's filled with water, by the way. There's no disappointing. Yeah, there's. Well, I have stuff to do after this. I can't be drunk.
What would you call that?
It's a stein. It's a beer stein.
A stein
or a beer mug. Beer mug or beer stein, either of those are acceptable.
A pint?
I think Picard would refer to it as a stein, number one.
Une chope, in French.
Oh, wait, what is it? How would it?
And I got cereal in my mouth. Une chope.
Une chope. A beer stein or a beer mug is
no,
a
just
chope?
Chope.
Oh, chope?
Hmm.
Ah.
Like ye old chope.
That's what he would really say. That's what he would say, chope. Hmm.
This episode picks up.
Take a sip from the shop.
This episode, for example, take
a sip on the ship from the shop, number one.
Oh my God, I can't deal with this.
Such a bad. It's such a. Sorry, go on.
I just can't. The Priest Wolf.
You didn't comment on my beanie or my hoodie
it.
Either.
I didn't comment on it, but I saw it. I saw that you're sporting all of the Picard stuff and you're looking
it's all
Flash.
So hype. I was Flash. Oh my god, yes. I am looking Flash. Thank you.
I'm loving it.
I didn't know what it was called.
My year old, like my 7 year old Moriarty shirt from Sherlock.
I would love it if he came back as a Kelvin Moriarty. Anyways, go on. Sorry.
Worf is depressed.
He's super depressed.
And so he's doing all of these Klingon things. He's set fire to his quarters. No, he's not. He's got a few candles on. He's not coming.
No,
to, he's not.
It's a thing. There was a fire pit in his quarters. Don't you remember candles? And then Picard's like,
it can't get up. Fire. Your quarters. Anyway, he's not coming to work. He's not coming into work. He's like a moody teen. Picard's like, I understand that you've been affected by the fact that you weren't able to like correctly convert these young people a few episodes ago. So why don't you go to Barath? Is the way he pronounces it the first time. Barath.
Then it's pronounced lots of ways at this. And so it's Kalis.
And so Worf goes and he embarks on a journey to kind of like, I don't know, to find his way, find Kalis, find his path, renew his faith in the Klingon religion, the Klingon faith. And on his journey, he has a vision of Kalis, but turns out it ain't no vision. It's Kalis himself. He's back.
It ain't no vision.
I'm back,
I love
Worf.
That.
Were
you impressed by Kalis?
No, I'm thoroughly unimpressed by Kalis, as I always was. I've always been thoroughly unimpressed by this rendition of Kalis. I feel like
he should have been played by Tony Scott or someone like or Little
epic.
Zeus should, or something like that. Yeah, maybe even Arnold Schwarzenegger. But although I have to give
Hulk Hogan, but with a Klingon like makeup, right?
What's that?
Andre the Giant.
Oh my gosh, was he around?
but with like Klingon makeup, right?
Because Kalis is 1,000 years old, like so he's like an ancient Klingon. That's why I imagine he had those kind of crazy ridges. He looked different from modern day Klingons. One might say he is the purest genetic form. Remain Klingon. Mach Ta'ashashi. I made that
skinny
up.
Legs.
I don't think that's what. You're saying he didn't match your idea of Kalis's fitness level.
I feel like Kalis was like the most badass of warriors, so he wouldn't have.
I don't know why they
there.
Aged him so much too. I don't know why those Barath scientists aged him so much either, because they could have made him like epic Kalis, like you know.
I think they made him
prime,
return
like,
at the point of his death, didn't they?
But
like
why
that.
Would you do that? You could, if you're returning from the afterlife, you should be able to return as like the most like Gandalf, the White.
The White.
He should have been like, yeah, like he should have been like Kalis the Blooded, the Bloodladen, and it, like he's just constantly bleeding.
Kalis
like
the
he's
Drenched.
Just like the Drenched. He would have been like, you know, some epic version of Kalis with like superpowers.
Anyway,
in my opinion.
Back
Anyways,
back to the matter at hand. Kalis comes back, but no wait. It's not really him, it's a clone.
Also, sorry, one more thing. Since we know so much about genetics in movies now, the Barath scientist could have also given him super strength. He's a weakling. He's defeated by both Worf and Gowron, which you haven't gotten to. I'm sorry, go on, sorry.
He comes back. It turns out it's the Barath... they're not really scientists. That's what's surprising here. But it's the Barath kind of guardians here. They're the guardians of everything sacred. They're religious people. And they've brought back Barath because they think that this is the a correct interpretation of the sacred scrolls, the sacred scripture. And so in comes in Meme Eyes Gowron, who's not happy with this. And so everyone tries to figure out who this guy is, what they're gonna do with him. Yeah, it's them. Worf. He hates Worf. He always hates, like, he I don't know. He's just,
well, Worf gives him so much trouble, though, all the time.
Worf we can rule the Empire together, Worf. He tells him at some point.
I will
point,
not.
Do you have
I will
honor?
Not go down this path.
Anyway, it's proven.
I must forever serve on the Enterprise where my ideas are being constantly rejected.
Where I can never do anything.
We should attack.
I will not rule an empire with you. I will be a bitter old... a bitter Klingon, I will be.
What happens by the end of the episode? It's just like everyone's kind of figuring out who he is. Once they figure out that he is a clone, they try to come to this conclusion of how can we use him with the Empire, and so they kind of use him as like, they decide to use him as a symbol more than an actual leader. So he's the Queen of England.
Which is interesting. He's the Queen of England, exactly. Oh my god. Kalis is the Queen of England is the best thing we've ever said on this show. That was great. That was the best. We don't even have to record anymore. The whole episode is over.
You're saying like this is a mic drop? This is the end?
Kalis, Queen of England! I have a question for you. Gowron explicitly says there hasn't been an emperor in the Klingon Empire for 300 years. Do you think he's being so specific that he means the masculine form? Or do you think like Empress Laurel, her story still has to unfold?
Well, she's a chancellor. She's not an emperor. No, she's not an emperor.
No, she's the empress, isn't she?
No, she's a chancellor.
Oh, she is chancellor.
I think that officially
she becomes mother. She becomes mother.
I would argue,
and I took that for empress.
Even though I think mother is a bit dumb as a title. I'm pretty sure that, like, going forward, it would make sense to say that she was mother of Klingons. Like, regardless of what we all think of Discovery and how they treat her character, I think that going forward, like, that's a title that she self-designates, and that, I mean, if she has a long reign, or if she's in power for, like, maybe 20 years, 25 years, or whatever, then it would make sense to say that, oh, that was the mother of Klingons. That was the first and last, like, mother of Klingons or something.
Right. Or they may designate her a queen at some point. Who knows? Her reign is still going on. Her tenure, rather, I should say, is still in place as of the end of Star Trek Discovery Season 2. So, I like that. I like the idea that Laurel is also kicking back somewhere during the events of this episode and may be consulted or even, you know, who knows? Like... Who knows? She might not be around. It's TNG, interesting to think.
TNG is like, well, this season of TNG is like 2369 or something like that, which makes it easy to go back 300 years. We're talking about 2069. So around the time of first contact, or a little after, for humans, they were the final emperor of the Klingon Empire was
in power at the time.
Yeah, or he was leaving power. He just left or something like that.
Right. Fascinating to think about. And then Kalis,
Think about it. We were barely doing our first contact thing, and they had like the last of the emperors,
right?
In space, it's crazy,
right?
Freaking Klingons,
yeah. Emperors in space. the Klingons are an awesome. I guess what you could just say race. They're as a race of people, they have an awesome history. It's filled with lots of battles.
I get people on my channel telling me I should say species.
The Klingon species versus the Klingon race. That's a good... I don't know... I'd have to dive back into the kind of meanings of those words. We're not going to do that on today's show, though. We're going to keep
going. It's too late for me. My playlist is called Star Trek Races. It'll stay that way.
Excellent. I don't disagree with races. I think they are a race of people.
I do too, but that's because
let me ask you
to be one race. That's the thing.
Yeah, agreed. That's my same view. So on a planetary level, whatever looks like a human and acts like a human is a human. It doesn't matter if it has horns coming out of its head.
Or
no ridges, or that's kind of actually a really compelling idea because that would mean Tyler is kind of afraid that he's not going to fit in to either world, but Klingons might actually accept him, and they kind of do in that game. Like, they don't really care what he looks like when he's playing that game with them.
Well, these are Klingons that are chilling out in, like, the Orion District or whatever, so these are clearly open-minded Klingons. These aren't, you know...
But they might actually be open-minded because the Orion thing is on the Klingon homeworld.
It's an Orion district on the Klingon homeworld.
Yeah. So you would think that, like, my idea of, like, a really terrible kind of people is that they would like have slaughtered all the Orions or like shipped them, you know, off the planet.
What terrible
but they
people.
Welcome the Orions. They're like, you stay in this, you stay in this horrible part of our world, our planet, with volcano fumes coming out everywhere, and
yeah, you stay
and
in try Gotham. To survive.
Yeah. The rest of us will live on our beautiful matte painting Klingon empire.
I do have notes we'll about this episode.
Okay. I think we can jump. Are you done with your summary?
Well, that was it. How do you feel about it?
It was a good summary. Your summary was better than my summary.
Oh, well. that wasn't the high standard. Your summary wow. this time was quite shite.
I concede to that.
It's the night shift.
I love that.
We here at Starfleet Boy are firm fans of the night shift.
Yes.
We enjoy it so much. Chance. We don't know why, but we love it.
Would you volunteer for the night shift if you served on the Enterprise and were like a bridge officer?
I think it depends on who the first officer is, because I've noticed mm-hmm. that coming in from the night shift, you have to ride in a turbo lift with the first officer and a whole bunch of people. Like, there's Riker and like four of the crewmen.
Right, it's a on whole that, shift. On, it's a on shift replacement. It's exactly. like a proper.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's like a proper shift and replacement.
You have to do that ride every morning. And so,
if you hate the first officer.
If you hate the first officer. Like, I couldn't do that ride with T'Pol.
Really? That's terrible. You couldn't put your feelings aside for T'Pol? She's great.
Well, I mean, if you're given the
you
choice.
You get really annoyed with T'Pol and be just like, I'm done.
If you're given the choice, then I would do it. In that situation, I would do the night shift so I don't have to do my
I see what you're
see what I mean? If you're given the choice, then I would, well, I
who,
would do.
Who do you think the commander is? I think on the Enterprise, on that Enterprise, the NX-01, I think the night shift worked a little differently. I think it was probably not as organized as it is.
Yeah, it was just all broken, wasn't it?
It was just all like, hey, Trip, I've been reading books late, as you know, I'm going to take the night shift for a couple of weeks. All right, Cap, you go do your thing.
All right, Cap.
I think I'm going to take the night shift in engineering and join you for a couple of drinks every now and then.
Have you
like
noticed that everyone in Enterprise...
I have no idea why I did that.
In their underwear?
Oh, yeah, that was great, too. I like that about Enterprise. That was really great.
I'm watching with wife on the tube, and she's like, why are they all naked all the time? And I said, oh, there'll be slow motion explosions, and it's very 2000s. So
there's very, I love it. It's very body positive.
Body positive.
It's great. It's like you can walk around in your underwear at night. It's fine. I wouldn't do it. I have shorts. I wear night shorts.
I have pajamas.
Oh, that's proper.
I have proper pajamas, and they represent things too. I have a Kylo Ren set of pajamas, which is awesome. This is before everyone started hating Star Wars. I still like Kylo Ren.
I like that YouTube channel where Kylo Ren watches movie trailers. Have you seen it?
No, I have not seen that.
You should. It's the best thing ever.
I'm not sure.
I'll send you a link.
I'm watching The Dark Crystal: Age of Resistance at the moment. That is the best thing ever. That is amazing.
Very nice.
Everyone should go out and watch The Dark Crystal, the movie, and then dive into The Dark Crystal, Age of Resistance, the TV show. It is true art. Like, everything...
You have no idea how happy it makes me that you love that show, because I love The Dark Crystal. And I am not finished yet with The Age of Resistance, but I'm probably going to finish it.
Everything
this
is
weekend.
So... Like, so it's just so... Like, yep. Everything is amazing. The craftsmanship, the aesthetics, everything. Oh, we can't do the aesthetics of the 60s. No one would like it. Well, I mean...
What guy was
the Dark
that?
The Dark Crystal.
Who was
that
guy? Was that a Skeksi?
that was CBS.
Aesthetics not good.
That's CBS.
Oh, my God. We've gone way off path.
We have.
Is there nothing to say? Well, so wait, we started talking about the actor... who plays Kalos, and then you went to your notes. Where were we, Sean? Come on,
I don't know.
Get back on task here. What was your last note?
My last note? On your feet. That's my last
on
note. What
feet.
Is that? Is that Picard screaming at Worf? On your feet.
Yeah, it was the best. It was
a
great
moment. He
gets
mad at Worf at some point, yeah.
And he walks in with like, I think Patrick, this is like one of those moments where they probably let Patrick Stewart flex his performance muscles because he walks in very like angry already in his face, you could see. But then he's like gentle for a moment, you know, just to make sure because Worf is his friend, right?
He's like,
but then Worf is just kind of slowly.
Do your thing.
Yeah. But Worf is slowly getting up. I like this about Picard. Worf is slowly getting up. And then Picard waits to see that Worf doesn't go all the way up. He just stays sitting on his bed. And he's like, what the fuck? I'm the captain. I've just walked into your quarters. And you are sitting on your bed? On your feet! On your feet, Commander! It was great. That's going to be my new alarm, actually, to wake me up in the morning, is the sound clip of Picard saying, on your feet, Commander. Wouldn't that motivate you to get up every morning?
I'm not sure, because I get up at midnight for work, so maybe...
It doesn't matter. Okay, fine. On your feet, it's midnight!
The episode does a good job at making you believe that it's careless, I find. Now, we all know it's not careless, because we've seen this episode a million times now, but... Right. I think it does do a good job. You're kind of underwhelmed and unimpressed by the fact that Kalis is kind of eh. But I think that contributes a lot to the fact that, like, how can I put this delicately? I probably can't. The fact that this isn't what I would have done for Kalis, the fact that this doesn't represent my idea what Kalis is, contributes to kind of like an anger. I'm like, oh my goodness, this is what they did for Kalis. And then I'm blinded to the fact that it couldn't be him. I'm in this mind frame of they've ruined Kalis. You see what I mean?
I hear you. I don't know if I felt that way. I don't know if I felt any of those emotions.
I would like them now to, and I've tweeted about this, and you said hashtag same. I would like them now to do an episode where they bring back, like where they real Kalis actually comes back, and so you could have him look like this guy. Except he's wearing all of these Jon Snowy fur coats, and he's friggin' awesome, right? But he can fight and he can really do it. It's the same guy. It's just that shows you that the clone kind of failed.
What if Kalis comes back in Star Trek Discovery Season 3? Because they're so far in
Discovery
in the future,
Season 3? He'd be a woman.
Yeah. That's okay. I don't care if he comes back as a woman. Actually, that's kind of awesome. But regardless, like Kalis can come back in Star Trek Discovery Season 3. It could be a thing. What if those fighters that we see wearing the...
From Game of Thrones, that's a nod to Star Trek. Do you think he did a nod to Star Trek?
Because
he wanted to write.
One never knows.
Martin wanted to write TNG at one point. He was refused as a writer for TNG.
Oh, and he got him back with the greatest show on like the history of the world. He was like, "Yeah,
well, arguably
you don't want me to be a writer."
maybe the was book series. I don't know. I haven't read them, but
well, Harry Potter's the greatest thing that's ever been made in our time. Just by sheer numbers.
I think a lot of people would agree with it. I think in if you were to count the sales and like the influence over a generation and like the impact, cultural like impact, I think that yes, you could be right. Probably. Then these things are hard to quantify, I suppose, but
yeah, it's just a feeling. But I don't have any data, guys. No data on this.
No doubt.
But yeah, do you think, what would you think of a Kalis coming back in Discovery Season 3? And he's the one who's leading those fighters, the fighters we see with the crazy guns.
So
I mean, future.
My beef with Discovery will be that they will like probably botch his aesthetics. But if they were to bring him back and he were to look pretty much exactly the same as this dude here.
No, he's going to come back as awesome. Epic Kalis. He's going to have like crazy. Natural.
You're defining a Super Saiyan. Oh, okay. Horns, all right.
he's gonna have like crazy natural horns and spikes. He's gonna look like a spiky dildo, basically, when he comes back. He's just
gonna be so imposing. That's for the audience.
There's like two listeners that have heard every episode of Starfleet Point, maybe five, and that was for them. That was just for those people. But you know what I'm saying. I don't know. I'm being belligerent. I know I'm being a little aggressive here, but I think that like both of us have a bias now about Star Trek Discovery. We are what I was saying earlier.
What are we?
You're Gowron and I'm Worf.
I'm Gowron? I'm gonna die?
Yeah. No, just in this episode. I mean, we all are going to die at some point. Hopefully it's an old age.
I love when Wolf gets mad and he's all like, you were grown in a laboratory? And he says, like, some sort of fungus.
Well, he wanted to kill. I think in his, like, the reason he was, like, he even turned his back towards them in that scene, which was kind of awesome. And I think because his instinct was to just pull out a batlet and slaughter all of them. Like, they've committed the most grievous dishonor you could imagine committing. All
right, so
I also have a note and a question, because okay. I think it's important to bring it up at this point in the discussion,
all right,
since we brought this up. All right, so Boreth, as a planet, we've now seen...
Boreth.
Is this the same temple that we see in Star Trek Discovery in Point of Light?
It is... I couldn't tell you. All right, here's the thing. It visually, it's not. It doesn't look like the same temple at all. But then there's, like, basically 300 or 200 years between. So even if it's, like, a very old temple, maybe something could have been added. It's a monastery. And they call it the Monastery in Boreth, but maybe there's there's different monastery. Like, the planet itself is the place. Boreth is the place to go, but it doesn't have to be the same monastery in TNG and in Discovery.
Just like we have, just like any following has, like, tons of monasteries right now. There's, like, you can go to a monastery in Greece, you can go to for whatever faith you follow. Yeah, so that makes sense. And maybe the Time Crystal Monastery is a whole different monastery, and Tanavik is still there. Wow.
Even if they have the same faith, there could be different monasteries for different, like, reasons. Like, this seems to be a specific place where you search for your vision of Kaelis. Like, everything seems to be directed around the fact that you're looking for the answers provided by Kaelis, so you're trying to get that vision. And so maybe this is, like, a special, like, Kaelis retreat kind of thing.
Now available as a package, the Kaelis Retreat. Come to Boreth and clear your mind of all your problems. Find the true light, brother.
No triples guaranteed.
No triples guaranteed. I love it. Well done.
Yeah, no, I think that maybe Tanavik's still chilling.
Yeah.
Okay, I feel like that... But this is so interesting now. Now we can, like, equate things to, like... Kaelis said, look for me at the Point of Light, and he goes to Boreth, right? Why does he go to Boreth? Because it's a freaking time planet. It's got time shenanigans. He could come back.
In Star Trek Discovery Season 3.
He could actually come back, because it's all about time travel and time warping.
Yes.
And maybe there's a secret chamber that you have to, like, open at some point that someone's going to find, where, like, Kaelis entered that and he's been chilling in there for 1,000 years and he'll come out.
You know what's fascinating about what you just said and kind of would be interesting is that it could explain if the time suits are both out of commission and, you know, you can't get time crystals anymore for whatever reason.
You think they get saved by Kaelis?
Well, not just that. I think Kaelis could return. I don't know if they're going to make him an important character or not. But so we've already, like, answered that question, which is kind of cool. I like the way you came up with that idea. But maybe this is how Georgiou gets back to the Discovery's time.
Mm.
And maybe Boreth, maybe the Klingon monks on Boreth, including Tanavik, know the outcome of things. And maybe they even manipulate timelines. You know, who knows? There's so many cool.
So I mentioned a little something in my trailer breakdown video about Discovery, and so that they do Andorians a certain way, and there were Andorians a certain other way in, like, the original series and Enterprise. And what I would love to see in Discovery or any modern Star Trek is, like, all of them. Like, I would love to see the Andorians from Discovery kind of chilling with Andorians from Enterprise, with Andorians from the original series, and so you have, like, all of this these variances. And that would, to me, cement the fact that they all exist, and it would be just amazing. And it would automatically become, like, one of the best Star Trek shows ever, just for doing that kind of stuff, for being brave enough and bold enough to, like, embrace all of Trek and all of its eras. And it would be amazing if they went to Boreth, they meet up with Kaelis, but they show us the temple that they designed, or that they filmed. Somewhere that they filmed in Toronto. So they show us that, but they also show us a set that resembles the one from TNG. Like, you go from one place to another on the planet and you have them both, and so you kind of understand that they are both there. That'd be awesome. Anyway, I'm too invested in these kind of
But I think that, Sean, I think that, like, if Discovery lasts long enough, like, it can't, it has the opportunity to do that.
Well, you know? I feel like it just doesn't want to, because going back to the Dark Crystal,
maybe they're just not going at your pace.
I'm only four episodes in, and they've already done quite a lot.
Right.
I mean, the Dark Crystal for me now is basically the template for what a prequel should be. If you want to ever do a prequel,
it's 100% true.
This is it. You have to watch the movie and then watch the show, and then now you know how to write a prequel. It's like it's 101 prequel. To me, everything is perfect. Everything works so well.
I can't argue with that. It is perfect.
I'm not
going to
say anything,
is not perfect.
In case someone wants to go and watch it, and I really don't want to spoil anything because it's intense and amazing. I discovered the movie just last year too. I had no idea it existed.
I didn't know that. Did you learn about it from Starfleet Boy?
No, I learned about it because Netflix announced the series. Netflix announced the show.
Brilliant.
And I was like, what do you mean?
What's
a prequel
that?
To what? And then so I went and I downloaded the movie and I watched it. And I think it's absolutely fantastic. I talked to you about it. I think I talked to Nick about it as well. I said, this thing's crazy. But it is. It's a classic, isn't it?
Yeah. I saw it when I was a kid. When it came out.
Mm.
I'm old. I'm just like Kalis.
Well, we'll take you to work one day.
That'll be great. Cool. I didn't think about that. And you actually kind of, for me now, I have even more ammunition towards why Discovery's getting to be a better and better show, in my opinion. Because
well, honestly, I said this in my reviews. I have a lot of quarrels and a lot of beefs with Discovery, but everything they did regarding Boreth, be it with their own plot lines, so the T'Navik plot line, that's their own thing, and everything that had to do with like the time crystals, because the time crystals helped me connect a lot of things with like the kind of time scientists that developed the technology for Janeway in Voyager.
Right.
I mean, it just everything that had to do with that, I think it was really good. Because other than that, I wasn't really a fan of what they were doing with the Klingons, but the Boreth thing I think was absolutely fantastic. I love it when they tie things in like that.
Going back to this episode, what was your least favorite scene, if you
My
can recall?
My least favorite scene?
Yeah.
I'm trying to think back. It's not something that I particularly dislike in this, I think.
Except Kalis himself. You just
well, yeah, it's Kalis himself that I'm unimpressed by him, I suppose. Because I like the way that Worf is all like a boss diplomat by the end of it. And I like, I don't know, I enjoy a lot of what's going on. I don't know.
That's a really good point that I didn't even think about until now when you said that Worf is like a boss diplomat. But he does kind of like... He's the one
it.
Who...
He resolves the
engineers
issue,
this whole scenario, yeah. Because like what was going to be the other choice was a civil war.
Yeah, basically. That's what they're saying anyway.
Hmm. Very cool.
I love the direction. It's directed by a guy, I wrote down his name, Winrich Colby.
Colby. He's directed a ton.
Yeah, so he directed a lot of TNG episodes, All Good Things, the finale, so being one of them.
Mm-hmm.
I think he died in 2012.
Okay.
So it's been a while, but his directing was amazing. I mean, this was good, and the visual effects. I kept on tweeting pictures of like the Bird of Prey facing the Enterprise because it just looks beautiful.
Yes.
But this is the remastered, isn't it? So. Getting that high quality.
Well, the planet looks better. Everything looks better. And that was a cool tweet. I remember seeing that, actually. The actor who plays Kalis is named Kevin Conway. And
okay.
You might... Let me see if there's anything here that you might know him from. Or I might even, actually, because I don't recall him off the top of my head. I don't think I've seen any of his performances. But it looks like he's a pretty established actor. He did a lot of work on TV.
Okay.
Like a ton of it. He's still working. He's currently in production of the Gettysburg Address, which might be an Abraham Lincoln based story. And the last thing he did was just last year, Unmasked, a TV series, and he's the narrator. But I've never seen that show. But yeah, he wasn't. Sorry to say this to you, Kevin Conway, but you were not my expectation of Kalis either when I was a kid.
Well, it's not his fault, is it?
It's not his fault, but he did do a great job. I thought what I liked about him was his voice.
Hmm.
Like, he was just gravelly and, like,
yeah,
you know, authoritative. Okay. And, like, you really, you know, he sells that for sure. Maybe, you know, I didn't expect a Kalis to be shorter than Worf and Kara.
And then we have to talk about this because, you addressed...
I also think it was a mistake, which has nothing to do with the performer, but to have him lose so easily in these knife fights, you know. I do think that Kalis...
That I understand. The dude has no experience in combat. He hasn't been trained or hasn't learned anything.
So you're saying it was a good clue. It was the first clue.
I think it
okay,
was.
Gotcha.
I think it was a good... Like, it's... Because even if he has all the memories of the battles that he's fought, he hasn't actually fought them and he doesn't know how to fight. He's never been trained. So this guy is basically kind of trying to fight off instinct. But it's not enough to hold off the Garon with the eyes.
That makes sense. I mean, that alone is very intimidating. It's true.
It is. He's scary. Okay, he's still Garon, the scary guy with the eyes at this point. But there comes a point in Deep Space Nine where he becomes like the meme. Like, we've had enough of the eye guy. So they give us someone that only has one eye instead.
The actor who plays Garon is awesome.
I know, he's so fun.
He goes to all the conventions, yeah.
We have to address this. You talked about it earlier, the Kalis from the original series, right?
Yes.
Scandalous
as well. I can't remember that episode, except for I do remember like the rock creatures, and so it's going to be fun when we do our TOS rewatch.
Mm.
But I do remember... I think it's probably been like close to 30 years, no joke, since I've seen that episode.
Okay. The Savage Curtain, it's called.
Yes. Sauvage. How do you say that in French?
Sauvage.
Le Sauvage. What? Curtain. How do you say
it? Le Rideau Sauvage.
Oh, wow.
It means nothing. The Savage Curtain is like the most meaningless thing. That means nothing. The Savage Curtain.
It means nothing to you, but at the time it meant something.
What did it mean?
To audiences, it meant like crossing the barrier from being civilized to a savage there's only a curtain separating it.
Okay.
That's what I think
the
it means.
The Savage Curtain.
Yeah.
So it's not the curtain that's savage.
So, Le Sauvage Curtain. It could be a curtain blowing in a heavy wind could be also... according to the description, the rock aliens, I did read the description for that episode.
Okay.
There's these rock aliens that wanted to discover... The reason why I made that supposition is because the summary says there's these rock aliens that are trying to understand the concept of good and evil.
Okay.
And so they bring back these historical figures to fight alongside Kirk and Spock. So Sirak comes back, and then so does Kalis.
So I don't like the Sirak that they gave us in that show, and I don't like the Kalis that they gave us in that show.
I can't remember. I just remember Kalis, in that episode, he was extremely tall and wearing furs. And then he comes back later on, and he has hair and no ridges.
But then he comes back, they devise a plot, as you say. So, like, Sirak could be, like, a false vision, so it doesn't necessarily have to, like, resemble him. I think the other ones is a bit... Anyway. Kalis!
Oh, actually, Sirak is the tall one. That's right. Kalis was short in this too, but he did not have ridges.
No, he was basically the only change they had like the original series makeup on the guy, except what they did is they made him a lot darker than usual because the Klingons kind of had a bit of like face paint on them. They were slightly darker. But this one was really dark. That's what's going on here, and he's got a fluff mustache or whatever it is.
Yeah, it was a different actor.
He's got
it
that fluff.
It would have been interesting, but I think the actor who played Kalis, the original in the original series, whoa, he's still alive. He could have played. Why didn't they bring back
Kalis.
TOS Kalis.
Why did they not bring back Kalis? I don't know.
That was weird.
There's a lot of things that don't sync up, but whatever.
It could have been that at the time, the actor Bob Heron was probably like, "What? You want me to play that awful character that I had to wear that awful dark makeup for?"
Yeah, but this time it's different. This time you have ridges, so I have more makeup.
F that, you guys. I'm too old.
Have you ever forced an idea, Picard? I love that.
That's a great scene. That is a great scene.
I love that. Garon opens his eyes even wider, and he's all like fighting an idea. Dude, come on.
By the way, that's Robert O'Reilly. We didn't mention his name.
Robert O'Reilly? I don't think I've ever learned his name. Robert O'Reilly.
I learned his name during my rewatches.
All right. He's great.
He's great. He looks nothing like Garon, but when they put the makeup on, he looks exactly like Garon.
Yeah, he turns into Garon. Oh, he kind of, to some certain point. He plays Scarface in TNG.
What?
He plays Scarface in one of like Dixon in the Dixon Hill programs.
Oh, no way. Interesting. Interesting indeed. He plays Garon the last time, it looks like, on TNG in this episode.
Okay. Yeah.
So this is his last appearance. That's what I'm saying. We've been doing these last... This is so sad. Have you noticed we've been noting these last appearances?
Well, because this is basically the end of this, like, the sixth season, isn't it? How many episodes are there after
this? Yeah, I know,
this?
But it's so sad. It's like...
We're doing last of everyone. I still can't believe that there's no more Guinan. Until the end of the show, right?
Until Generations. It's crazy.
That's insane. Generations is not necessarily the best of movies, but I love what it does for continuity and, like, canon, basically. It ties in so many things. We have, like, the Duras sisters, and it shows us about the Elorians, and it brings in Guinan. I don't know. It's so cool. They do the Picard killing. But...
Wait, look. Now is the time. Picard family forever. Rene!
Forever.
Robert!
Papa.
It's so awful. Papa. Why do they... Do you think... I would love it if Q would grant the return of Rene.
He doesn't have that power.
Robert. What are you talking about? Of course he has that power.
Mm. I feel like if Q made someone come back like that, it wouldn't really be them. It would be just like imitations. Clones.
I think it would require something.
Clones.
Clones. I think whatever my scenario in my head, if they wanted to make it kind of like sad, even over the top, perhaps, is that Q can do that for one person only, but it means Q ends himself. Like he's literally replacing his existence to bring this other person back from
just a human. Why would he do
non-existent.
That?
Non-existent. Well, Picard's biggest lament is that his family won't go on, and so the gift that Q gives... Q's bored. He's done. He's like, Jean-Luc, I want to go on my next adventure. It's no big deal. And he gives him one gift, and it's like, we get Rene Picard, and then the next Star Trek show that's set on the Enterprise is Captain Rene Picard, who goes through Starfleet Academy, etc., etc., etc.
So... Okay,
So Robert still dies, sadly, in the fire.
Woman,
but Rene is saved and goes on to have a career in Starfleet. And Picard, that's like point, the, you know.
There comes a point in the life of a woman where she can't have children anymore. It's like post-menopause, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Men, that doesn't happen, right?
That's right.
So Picard's like maybe 75 or whatever. Could he still have a child?
It's possible.
It's a thing that's possible?
It is possible. I mean, the girl, Daj, could be his child, in a way.
Yeah, that's a theory. I don't like that one.
Yep. By the way, these Star Trek Picard speculations are totally relevant because we're talking about TNG, which directly relates to what's coming in some way. Like, there's definitely going to be elements.
Well, this is very Klingon-centric, so I think Klingon-centric is, as you say, more Discovery than it is Picard, because Picard seems to be a very Romulan Borg.
But TNG was the original Klingon-centric show. There was so much Klingon.
So much going on in it. And then they did a lot more in Deep Space Nine, I think. But yeah, no, this was... Well, it's because they went from being the bad guys to...
I'm tired of the freaking Klingons. I'm tired of the Klingons. I'm like, let's go on. Let's move on. How about Tellarites?
I agree with that. I think that Discovery should have just given us something like a new race entirely. It makes sense for Picard
yeah.
to carry on with the Borg. I don't know, but it makes sense for Picard to carry on the Romulan plotline because that was huge.
Yes,
and it was taken up like basically, it was everything at that point in time. So it only makes sense to continue.
As Humbert likes to point out, it feels like it's never even resolved in TNG. Like nothing happened. And there's all this tension between the Romulans, yeah. and it goes out into like a poof. You get the resolution in Star Trek Nemesis, but Nemesis is interesting because what you're actually getting is like the first signs of friendship between the Romulans and the
But then it's because they're working against like a common enemy, or at least an enemy that, you know, they're working against.
But Commander, but you have to consider Commander Denatra overall has a reverence for Picard, and also like she seems to be very like friendly towards him. Like
I think she's arguably one of the best Romulans ever.
Yeah, she's fantastic. She's awesome. I wish we had more Commander Denatra.
She's in a movie that like not a lot of people like, but she's awesome.
Yeah. I wish there was a Commander Denatra.
Exactly. They should have brought back her instead of Kalis.
That was one of my theories, by the way, is that Picard
that
married...
Kalis?
Picard married Denatra. And, like, it was going to... Remember, I was, like, totally...
Oh, yes, you were totally... Do you think we're going to see Beverly Crusher and Picard?
They have to. I can't accept a no on that one.
The Doctor from Voyager is returning,
Gates,
or at least Robert Picardo is returning for season 2.
I'm a huge Gates McFadden fan. And a huge Dr. Crusher fan. Mm. Beverly's my jam.
Beverly's my jam.
She is.
Beverly.
She's also my space mom. She's actually Will Wheaton's
space mom. The ghost-loving doctor.
I think there should be a line of merchandise about space mom on Star Trek. Just saying. Ooh, did you hear that? That's my text message notification. It sounds like
CBS has contacted you. They're like, yes.
The communicator.
What else? Do you have any more notes? I don't have notes.
No, other than the little interesting tidbits that we get about Kalis himself, I think I think it's interesting how
I've got Ben Denis, Jon Snow / Garon.
Oh, at the end, you're saying to the Khaleesi. Yeah, that's more of your comparison to the Khaleesi.
It is.
Star Trek,
I won't bend the knee. He's all like, I won't bend the knee to this imposter.
Yeah.
And so
those are old. The Klingons are always portrayed, I think, in the manner in which they speak. They're very like old-fashioned, like almost like old English in the manner in which they speak. Like it's very like, you know,
yeah.
It's dramatic, for lack of a better word. And I think that's the same in Game of Thrones, is that they're speaking like, you know, Game of Thrones takes place in another place, not on Earth. Caldon in Aria. I'm making up the words, I don't remember. But
and who you, the proud lord, said that I should bow so low.
Castamere, very nice.
The Reigns of Boreth.
Hey Siri, play the
you're gonna get
Pogo
flagged
song about Star Trek. No, Pogo's fine.
You think?
Okay, playing Something I Would Do by SPM.
That's not what I wanted to. Hey Siri, stop. Hey Siri, stop. This is a little. You're not on the next episode, but it's another cloning episode, another twin episode. Where Riker finds Thomas Riker.
Yeah, I don't know why I was invited to this one instead of the other one, but whatever.
Oh, wow. Well, if you can come back at 4, if you can come back at 4, you're welcome.
I can't, I'm sorry. I have an argument. Thomas Riker is hotter than William Riker.
I agree with the argument, so that's not an argument at all. But I was also, since we just brought it up, two facts that I don't think Jamie will know as well, since he's not as versed about Star Trek, but the little... metal thing that they walk across to get to the other side at the end of the episode to get the data core is the same red metal thing that Captain Kirk dies on.
Oh my goodness. Is it really?
In Generations. Yeah. You got to watch it again. You'll totally be like, oh crap. And it's almost the same angles too. Like shot for like almost like similar shots.
That episode is directed by LeVar Burton as well.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I got invited to the wrong episode.
Ew! Don't say that.
No, I'm kidding.
You're terrible. You're making me feel bad. Oh my god! Wow.
It's not true. It's a lie. Every episode.
I have to try to double up a little. So yeah. Put your name on the ones you really
it's
want.
Fine.
Make
it's
sure
fine.
You go on that database.
You do you with whoever you need to, and then I'll be here for the episodes that no one wants to do.
That suck.
That no one cares about.
Wow. All right. Fine. Message heard, number one.
I am but a tool. I am but a tool to help Starfleet Boy carry on. Is that for me? Is that my one?
Yes, look.
Number one.
No, this is my half, but I'll send you one. I have your address.
You don't need I'll to. Don't worry good. About it.
So, I got a present from a listener, and then I went apeshit. I went on StarTrek.com, and
just
I was like,
everything.
Oh, there's almost everything. Excuse me. That's that nasty upper respiratory.
What would you rate this episode? Are we doing ratings?
Whoa, that was terrible. What's that? We're doing ratings. Why would we break
Are we
from...
doing them now? Or do you
yes,
have
I
more
think
notes?
So. No. There are no more notes.
There are no notes. All right.
I really like this discussion. I can give that a 10 for sure.
Oh, yeah.
I give this episode a 6.5.
Ooh. God, that's low.
I don't remember.
Compared to your usual 11s, right?
One of the criteria I use, and I feel like in season 6 and season 7, the reason I've been throwing around so many 10s is that, like, if I watch it over and over, this is an episode that I only needed to see once. I understood all the canonical implications, the adding to the legend, but I don't actively go, oh, I'm going to go watch Rightful Heir, like when I think about rewatching Star Trek. But I do think it's important, so it deserves more than, you know, it's an important episode, but it's not like necessarily one that I remember enough to watch over and over. So sadly, that is the reason for my low rating on this one. Plus, I also disagreed with Kalis. I agree with your disagreement about Kalis.
Disagree
and then
with
we
Kalis.
Didn't. we touched on this a little bit, but I thought the scientists were just the most idiotic. The Boreth Guardians were just the most idiotic.
Where's T'Navik to like sit them in the like T'Navik died or something, or T'Navik's off on vacation, and they're doing all this. When he
or
gets
these
back,
are the,
he's going to give
I
them
the right
whooping.
I think these are, you know, T'Navik's order of Guardians protects time or, like, watches over time. And I think their order is the one that watches over the return of King. Like, there was a throne room in their thing.
So the time protectors are here in this tower just shaking their heads at the Kalis protectors here.
Yeah. They're just like,
they're
oh,
like,
crap, what?
God damn it. You know, like, just these guys. These guys. They give Boreth the bad reputation, right?
Right. They're like, the guy, what's these his people. Name? The We didn't talk about the character, but Koroth is just a complete moron as a character, in my opinion. And so, yeah, we didn't talk about it in the discussion.
It's interesting that Garon didn't just kill them all, like,
that's what I'm saying.
Kill
it's like
all.
I'm surprised Garon
kill
is
all of
so patient.
The priesty guys.
He's
the
like this.
This
monastery has become insane. These Klingons have completely lost their minds. Erase them from our genetic population.
Someone asks him like, "What happened on Boreth?" He's like, "They were all mad. Just got rid of them. Whatever."
But I do appreciate this discussion because you enlightened me as to the fact that Boreth doesn't have to be like one monastery on a whole planet.
No, I don't think it
I
does.
Think that's brilliant. No, I think it's brilliant.
They,
and I
they,
think
they
that's like something
Boreth.
That we don't think about often.
They talk about the Boreth Monastery, but it's never stated, oh, it's Boreth Monastery, you know, this name. You know? It's not Shakar
yeah.
on Boreth.
Yeah.
So it could be like different monasteries. It could be just different sections.
It could also be that at different eras of different kinds of things had prominence on Boreth, right? So like maybe all the time crystals die, and that's how they, except for a few that like.
Well, for all we know, the temple that they have in TNG could be very old, but like in Discovery, it's abandoned, right? Like they've stopped using it. But when once TNG picks up, they've started using it again.
Yeah, there's so many cool.
This, you can tie it in however you want.
Yeah, the answers could be in the TOS film era. For more information about Boreth, it would be interesting to.
This is what the short tricks should be used for.
I agree. Yes, we agree. All right, so that's my rating, 6.5. How about yourself?
I'm inclined to kind of agree here. I'd give it a 6, maybe.
You always have to go a little lower than me.
I can't do more. No, I was pretty much going for a 6 in the first place. I think that it's not a bad episode by any means. I really like the direction. And I like the concept of people bringing back a clone, and Garon has to deal with that. It's kind of weird. It's just, well, again, there's like we never see any of this repercussion, and we never see the guy again. Like in Deep Space Nine, they could have maybe had this dude be like a moral supporter, like during the war. There's like a Dominion war going on, and no one ever talks about Kahless. There's like a Kahless clone chilling somewhere.
Kahless is busy being the emperor, man. He's living in the palace. He's
sipping jitters on a beach somewhere.
He's sipping jitters on a beach somewhere, exactly. Kahless was chilling. Yeah. He was unaware completely of the war, Dominion War.
The what? The Dominion. What is that? All right, whatever.
This is beneath Kahless. go take care of this little petty war, Gowron. And when you return, we will talk of real.
Yeah, Gowron never returned.
Yeah, we all know how that goes.
Yeah. What's his name? Ah, the new emperor. Oh my goodness, I don't have his name anymore. The new chancellor.
Kim Peck? No.
No.
The Chancellor.
Oh my goodness, I forgot his name.
What did you, are you on Memory Alpha? I can look it up for you if you want to keep going.
I'm trying to search it.
On your defense, Martok. On your thesis defense. Martok, of course.
Martok comes back, but Martok comes back and he's just like, kill the Kahless, right?
Yep. Played by J.G. Hertzler, who's also, all the actors who play Klingons tend to be really interesting people.
But as opposed to Starfleet officers, they're all boring actors.
Look, you were doing that little segment for a while with extras.
Wasn't a segment.
It was. I think you thought it was too harsh when you started realizing that they're real people. By the way, my gosh.
Hashtag extras are people too.
Hashtag extras are people too. It's true. Now you know what it's like to be the Queen of England or Kahless. You're in public life, my friend. Anyways, so 6 from you and a 6.5 from me. So I think it's safe to just round it out at a 6.
All right.
We could get really like 6.12, but I think 6 is fine. Good. You're totally welcome to be on the next discussion. I feel really bad.
No, it's fine.
But
don't worry about it.
Do you want to throw? Obviously, you watched it recently. Do you want to throw a rating in, just so that we can theoretically mix it into the discussion? You said no.
I said no.
You said no.
You weren't expecting
you
that.
You say no.
I say no.
Very well, number one.
No, I said. All right. I reserve my ratings to when I'm on the show.
That's a Starfleet Boy exclusive. Excellent. Audience, go check out Trek on the Tube at YouTube.
You can check out my most recent video, which is a controversial review of the first episode of Short Treks of this new batch, Q&A.
I am so excited to watch it. And I have to go catch up. Tomorrow are my catch-up days for all the wonderful YouTube content that my friends are putting out. So I'll go do that as well.
All right.
I'm excited. All right, live long and prosper, Sean.
Yeah. Everyone.
You look so sad. You look so sad. Live long and prosper, everybody. And we'll see you next time.
I'm not depressed. I'm not like Wolf.
He is so depressed. Oh my god. All right, I gotta stop this recording. This is so complicated now. You could just hit a button before. There we go.